God, for what you want to do for us, God, in this house. Ooh, God, we thank you. 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 We thank you, God. We pray for all leaders, God, on today, God. We pray for all churches on today, God. That's more important than the name of Jesus, God. God, whether that be through social media, God, God, or in person, God, we pray, God, that you would bless those encounters, God. Hallelujah. We pray, God, you would bless those moments, God. We pray, God, that you would lead the leaders, God, as you see fit, God. Take control, God, of all of us, Lord God. Our hands belong to you, God. Our feet belong to you. Our lips belong to you, God. Our eyes belong to you, God. We thank you for the person of our lives, God. They belong to you, God. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, God. And in saying that, God, we give our hearts back to you, God, today, God. We give our hearts back to you, God. In the name of Jesus, God. That you would take control of our minds, God. Oh, hallelujah. Have your way in this place, God. Have your way in this place, Father God. God, in the name of Jesus, God. Oh, God, send plague creep into this place, God. Hungry, God. Thirsty, God. Do it, God, in the name of Jesus, God. And Father God, we bless you, God. We bless you, God. We bless you, God. We bless you, God. Even for the week that's coming forth, Father God. We bless you ahead of time, God. Hallelujah, God. And we say thank you, Lord God. Oh God, in the name of Jesus. It is in Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Come on, Jesus, and let's give the Lord a glorious praise. Come on, step on your feet, and let's give the Lord a glorious praise. A glorious, victorious praise. We're alive. We are alive. We are well. We are forgiving those things which are behind. And we are reaching for those things that are before. We are pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. Somebody give God a praise because we got a prize. Come on, give him a praise because we got heaven in our view. Give him a praise because we are serving the true and the living Savior. The soon coming King. Hallelujah. He's coming soon. He's coming soon. He's coming soon. We are preparing to meet our God. He's coming soon. And today we celebrate him. Today we gather. The Bible says where two or three are gathered together in his name, he is there in the midst. Lord, we thank you that you're here with us. We thank you that you're healing bodies. We thank you that you're delivering. We thank you that you're making a way. We thank you that you're saving souls. We thank you today, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, Jubilee. Give the Lord a glorious, victorious praise. Woo! When I think of the goodness of Jesus, when I think of what he brought me through, when I think that I stand here today, what am I testifying? The Lord is my portion. The Lord is my strength. The Lord is my rock. Hey, he is my fortress, my God. Hallelujah. Oh, I bless him this morning. I wonder if I have any people that came to bless him. I wonder if I have some people that came to join me and magnify the Lord. We don't magnify anything but the Lord. He is our keeper, our healer, our deliverer, our savior, our way maker, our bridge, our lawyer. He is our strength, our peace, our joy. Today we magnify him. Hallelujah. 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 Can you testify this morning? Can you testify of his goodness this morning? He broke me out. He brought me out of the miry clay. He placed my feet on a righteous name. He put a song in my soul today. A song of his praises. Yeah. Oh. might as well give God praise in here. He might as well give him glory in here. He is a wonder in my soul. He is a wonder in my soul. Hallelujah, I'm just so grateful. Why are you taking so long, Pastor? He's so good. He's just so good. He's better than good. Hallelujah, he's better than good. Words can't articulate how good God is. But God, we celebrate you today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. God bless you today, those of us reading. We want to welcome you to our live service. Here in Judah Live, yes, our doors are open, and we are praising God. If you want to join us, we're at 5520 East 10th Street here in the city of Indianapolis, Indiana. We're directly at 10th and Ritter right now from Community East Hospital. And we have gathered together this morning to celebrate our King. Let me say that again. I said, we have gathered this morning to celebrate our King. We have gathered this morning. And we get our minds on Jesus. Get your mind. Clear your mind of everything but Jesus. Because we need a touch and we need a word from the Lord. Only a touch and a word from the Lord will do. God bless you this morning as you're streaming. Those that are streaming, if you would share our video with friends, tag somebody in it. Let them know that Judah Light is alive and there's a word from the Lord for their life. God bless you as our praise team say, glory to God. Thank you.
I'm going home to live with Jesus. Thank you.
you. You've been a mighty good God. You brought me from a long way. If it had not been for the Lord who was on my side.
Girl, we're glad to have you today. Come on, give God a praise.
wish I had some people that felt like Pastor this morning. I'm so glad that God went with her. Can I tell you something? Can I give everybody some encouragement? You can't die before your time. Oh, I wish I had some people that believe what the pastor just said. You can't die before your time. Can't nothing take you out of here unless God is through with you. And one thing I found out, God ain't going to get through unless you get through it. Well, I say, I'm on God's time. I'm on God's time. Somebody say, I'm going to live. Come on, say, I'm going to live. I don't care what people are doing. I'm going to live my life in Jesus Christ. God bless you this morning. Amen. Once again, glad to see each of you walking in the house of God. God is a wonder. Amen. Aren't y'all glad to be in our new church home? Because every day is getting better and better in this place. Half, well, I have maybe 35% of the flooring is in on the bottom level. Give God a praise. Almost up there. I'm praying. And the event team came in last night and were working in the kitchen. And they pulled out magic. Now, we asked each other, they asked us what we want to keep. And so, you know, what they took. So, most of the kitchen stuff, if I said it was good, leave it. So, the event team pulled out all this stuff out of the kitchen. And we have a lot of nice utensils and silverware and bowls and stuff, all these items in the kitchen that they left. So they took that stuff off, bleached it, washed it, cleaned it, and the kitchen looked a wreck because they had all these stuff on the counters, all this stuff. Well, I came in there today and the counter was clear. I said, Lord, they came in last night, worked a few hours. We're talking about praise for our big team. Thank you for your sacrifice. Sister Tamika, Mother Vivian, Sister Amia. Is Amia not here today? Okay. She don't feel well. She's all right. Okay. We're going to be praying for her. She was here yesterday. Amen. God is a wonder, and I'm so glad. This is our last Sunday with Brandon and Jordan as they get ready to go back to school. Amen. So we're going to miss them here. Let's thank God for our young people that are in school. We're going to be praying for them. Amen. Before service ends, I would like to anoint them both with some oil in Jesus' name, just for God's protection. Amen. 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 As the fiscal team takes their place, amen. God is certainly, as we prepare to worship the Lord again, let's be deacon faithful in our tithes and offerings. Don't forget our building fund is still going on, and we're going to continue. With our building fund, I haven't given you a total yet. It ain't gone down, it's gone up, but I'll wait to give you the next total, all right? It is. In fact, can I tell you something? We've been so blessed with our general offering that we have not had to touch our building fund at all yet. That's a worthy praise right there. Because you may think that light, but we've spent tens of thousands of dollars already. So to say that goes to tell you, we spent a lot of money already, tens of thousands. Not just 1,000, tens of thousands. So to say that we still have not touched our building fund, that's a worthy, give God praise. So let's be faithful, continue to be faithful, If you could, just continue to be generous, give God an increase this year. Somebody say an increase. If you've been giving God $5 for 10 years, you didn't give God an increase. Okay, you work a job and they pay you the same amount for 10 years. How you gonna feel? Why you do God like that? You know, I had a pastor friend of mine tell me one time, he said, the Lord impressed upon him to start tithing what he wanted to make. I don't know if you understand that principle. Because most of them are all supposed to be tithing. Are you with me? But he said he's been tithing. He said the Lord impressed upon him to tithe on what he wants to make. So let's say he was making $30,000 a year.
He didn't tithe off the 30,000. He tithed as if he was making 50,000. Even though he was making 30,000. Some of you may want to consider tithing on what you want to make. Now, you don't have to. That ain't biblical. That ain't biblical. And I'm telling you just in presence. So I'm not saying that. I have to tell them. No, I'm not saying that. But if you want an increase, why don't you give God an increase? They taught us when we were growing up that you can't need God's giving. No matter how hard you try, God is not going to let anybody outdo you, Brother Chris. I'll witness. I love this church because we are to the life and we teach a life to Christ. We teach a life to serve. We teach a life to give and a life to praise. This is such a giving church, and I am appreciative of each of you. You all have been a blessing. You know, and let me say this. Sister Rena, I've never said this, and this is, she has been such a blessing to this church, even when she wasn't going to this church. And I want you to know that we appreciate you. And I mean that from the bottom of my heart. I don't have to call anybody out, but God has just blessed this church. No matter who's come, who's gone, this church has continued because God called this church into existence. And because of your faithfulness as a church member, and as a family member of this house, and as a family member of the body of Christ, your faithful giving, continue to give. Somebody said it's not equal giving, but it's equal sacrifice. You know what is a sacrifice to you? Let's be sacrificial in our giving, amen. Let's continue to pray for our fiscal team, amen. Thank God for them. Give God a praise for them. Amen. We're going to be under the direction of the ushers at this time in Jesus' name.
Just
blessed. Some of y'all didn't shout. They shout, you're blessed.
God promised me on the promised land, But the land was already occupied by the Canaanites. But can I tell you something? When God promises you something, he'll evict the enemy so you can take your place. Somebody ought to shout right there. Eventually, you know, after that, watch this, battle after battle after battle, the Israelites had enemies that they had to fight. And as we come to our text today, in 1 Samuel chapter 17, the stage is set for the Israel to fight another enemy. This enemy was the Philistines. The Philistines. The Philistines were from the land, and it's synonymous with Palestine, that we're familiar with today, the Palestine. And you know, the Palestinians to this day have been against Israel. And they have fought over land until this day. They are still fighting the Palestinians. So the Philistines are setting themselves in battle against Israel. Now watch this. Israel didn't go to them. They came to Israel. Mm-hmm. The Bible tells us, as I set the stage for the text, that they came to a part of Judah. And they made camp there. And they came and they began to intimidate the children of Israel. The Bible says they both set up the stage for battle. They both the Philistines and Israel, aligned themselves in battle formation against one another. Here the Philistines had a secret weapon. The Philistines had a secret weapon. Somebody say a secret weapon.
Secret weapon.
Although they had a secret weapon, the Bible tells me that that no weapon formed against. Come on, talk to me here this morning. No weapon formed against us will be able to prosper. Israel had one thing. The Philistines had a secret weapon, but Israel was protected by the Lord of hosts. Okay. Let me say that again and help you. Let me take it a little further. The Philistines had Goliath.
Yep.
And anybody knows scripture, Goliath was a giant.
Yes.
Can I tell you something? Goliath was such a giant that Shaquille O'Neal had nothing on him. Okay, Shaquille O'Neal is about 7'1", somewhere, thank you. I have two brothers, so see, you can tell they keep up with sports because they knew just how tall he was. I knew he was over 7 foot, assistant pastor. They said 7'2". Okay, thank you for correcting me. But as big as Shaquille, they say his shoes are like monsters. 22 What you say? His shoes. Can you imagine Pastor right now standing next to Shaquille O'Neal? I probably wouldn't even be. I don't know. I'd probably be at his hip. I turn around and have to turn back around because of where I would put it. No. Shaquille O'Neal is a big. In fact, he's one of the biggest men on this planet right now. One of them. I mean, huge dude. But can I tell you something? Shaquille O'Neal didn't have nothing on Goliath. If you look at scripture, they say that Goliath was 6 cubits in a span. 6 cubits. Y'all have no clue what that is, Pastor. I don't understand nothing about cubits in a span. So can you break that down in English? Can you tell me? Well, if you calculate or transfer what he was in, what the Bible says, 6 cubits at his span, it would equate to Goliath being 9.75 foot tall. Mm. In other words, Goliath was almost 10 foot tall. Mm. Okay, so if Shaquille O'Neal is 7'2", Goliath was almost 3 feet taller than him. So I would probably be at his knee bones. If I was standing on 10 foot, if I was standing next to Goliath today, I would probably be right around his knee area somewhere. So you can imagine talking about, they talked about the Canaanites were giants. This Philistine, Goliath, was a gargantuous character. He was so big, watch this. Goliath was so big that the Bible said he wore a coat. Watch this. His coat weighed 1,000 shekels of brass. 1,000 shekels. His coat. In other words, watch this. If I transfer that into weight, his coat weighed, are you ready? 125 pounds. His coat alone was a monstrosity. Then he had a spear that he carried. He had a spear that he carried. The spear weighed 600 shekels of iron, which means it weighed 15 pounds. Can you imagine this dude being almost 10 foot tall? Then he wear a coat that was 125 pounds. Then he had a spear that was 15 pounds. You can't tell me that the Philistines didn't have a secret weapon. They had a secret weapon. But I have to remind us that although they had a secret weapon, that no weapon formed against us would be able to prosper. Why is that? Because we serve a God that is the Lord of hosts. Pastor, I don't even know what that means. The Lord of hosts says that not only does God do battle for us, he has a host of angels that do battle for us. I wish y'all would believe the word of God. Not only does God do battle for us, he has a host of angels. Y'all gotta remember, only a third of the angels fell from grace with Lucifer. Only a third, and there are legions of angels. There are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of angels. So can you imagine, if only a third fell with Lucifer, that means two-thirds stayed with God. Oh, that means we got thousands of angels that look after us. Can you imagine that God has been protecting us all of our life, that he's got angels around us? Give me scripture, Pastor. The Bible says that the angels of the Lord encamp round about them that fear him. I wish y'all would have shouted right there. When I just said, y'all act like that was just something common. Can I tell you something? Can I quote that again and bring that closer to home? In other words, if I'm a child of God and I walk in the fear, the reverence of God, if I keep in mind that he's the Lord of my life, he's the head of my life, every day there's a camp of angels that camp round about me. The reason why everybody in here is alive, because there's angels encamped around the house. Okay, deal with camp. What does camp mean? That means that you pitch a tent, you surround. So we are surrounded by angels. I don't know how y'all so sadistic and cute today. I said you're surrounded by angels. The reason why you're alive is because you are surrounded. God assigned angels to your life to protect you. That's why that car accident didn't take you out. That's why cancer didn't take you out. That's why that sickness didn't take you out. That's why that heart condition didn't take you out. That's why that gun that was shot into your house didn't take you out. Because the angels of the Lord are in camp. They're all around. Israel had a secret weapon called Goliath. Now, when they came to battle, they set up battle, they set up their formations, they were getting ready for warfare. And what the Philistines did, they brought their secret weapon in front, y'all. The quickest way to intimidate God's people is to put a giant in front of them. Pastor, what's your title today? I haven't given my title yet, have I? Turn to somebody close to you and tell them it's time to kill Goliath.
All right now.
Mm-hmm. I wish y'all said that. I asked you to say it, and I appreciate your obedience. But please turn to somebody with the boldness of the Holy Ghost now and tell them it's time to kill Goliath.
It's time to kill Goliath!
What the enemy did, they had an army. The Philistines had an army. But here they had a secret weapon called Goliath, approximately almost 10 feet tall, with a spear 15 pounds. And this Goliath stood in front of Israel's army and began to shout things against them. Began to call Israel names. Began to tell them, you ain't that tough. And we gonna tear you down. And we gonna wear you out. And we gonna kill you. And we gonna, you know, when the enemy starts talking, you gotta be careful. You gotta know when the enemy starts speaking in your ear, because as soon as he starts speaking to you, either one or two things are going to happen. When he speaks, you're going to do what the Bible says. The Bible says, submit yourself to God and resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So either you're going to resist him when he begins to talk, or you're going to shudder in fear and begin to listen to what Satan is shouting. Goliath began to shout all of these terrible things against the children of Israel. He began to shout against their God. There's one thing you talking about me. There's one thing you talking about when. But when you begin to defy God, you put yourself in a dangerous place. Listen, watch this. Let me kind of backtrack it. It's one thing to talk about me, and you got to be careful when you talk about me, because I am a child of God. The Bible says if you offend the least one of them, you would be better to have a rock about your neck and to be cast into the sea than to offend the least one of mine. But when you talk about me, the Bible says that. But when the Bible says when you come against God, you have really set yourself in a place of danger. Oh, so Goliath began to shout because he was a giant. He knew he was taller than every Israelite. The only Israelite that had, the most height was the king. Saul, if you go back a few chapters, I think it's 1 Samuel chapter 9, the Bible tells us that Saul, the king of Israel, was the tallest man from the shoulder up than anybody in Israel. So Saul, the king of Israel, was tall himself, but he was no match in size for the Goliath of the Philistines. So Goliath began to shout. And the Bible tells us in the text that Israel and Saul, the king, got scared. I want y'all to hear, Pastor, today. Israel and all the Bible says Saul and Israel were afraid. They were afraid, and the Bible says not only were they afraid, they were greatly afraid and dismayed. Dismayed means they was disheartened because of Goliath, because of the height. They weren't, now before, watch this, before they saw the secret weapon, they were fine. They were set up in battle. They were ready to go. We don't care who you are, Philistine, but as soon as Goliath stepped forth and started talking crazy, Israel started shaking their boots. Thanks to God. Can you imagine? Here is Saul, the king of Israel, being afraid, knowing that God is on Israel's side. So somehow his mind got twisted to forget that God was on his side. Can I stop here for a moment and encourage you to life? Don't let the devil twist you with fear. God is on your side. Saul, not only, and I gotta give clarity, the Bible didn't say that just Israel was afraid with Saul, it said all of Israel. Can I get thank you, Chief. Can I tell you something? You know, Israel in the Old Testament represents the church of the New Testament. Mm-hmm. I want y'all to get this. Israel is a type of the church. That's why the God's people
under the Old Testament was Israel. It was God's chosen people. But when Israel didn't hear God and didn't want to obey God, God said, I'm going to choose a people that fill them with my spirit, the Holy Ghost, in the New Testament. So Israel is the type of a church. Can you imagine this church, Israel, that saw God deliver them from the Egyptians, saw God destroy the Egyptians in the sea when they passed through on dry ground, when they saw God kill the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amalekites, and all of that? They knew that God was a man of battle, that he was the Lord of hosts. But this day, when the secret weapon comes forth, Israel starts to shudder, till all of Israel was afraid. Can I tell you something? That's almost like today, looking at many of our visible churches, many of them are afraid because of the giant Goliath.
Come on.
Of our churches, I'm going to say it, they're talking about wisdom. They're talking about the CDC. They're talking about all this stuff. They're talking about COVID. Churches are shut. Lights are off. People are virtual streaming while they're working in the kitchen. They're streaming and doing other chores. They're not paying attention to the church service anyway. You streaming, but you ain't paying attention fully because your mind is in your house. You haven't gathered with the people of God. It's because Satan put out a secret weapon. And when that secret weapon came out, everybody began to get fierce.
Come on.
And everybody, the whole, many, how many of our churches, there are more churches closed than there are open. What is wrong with this picture? We're getting closer to the coming of the Lord, and churches are closed because of some virus. Are you kidding me? We had viruses since we've been on this planet, and now the churches are closed. Even the government hasn't even closed our churches and haven't mandated again that our churches be closed. But we've got pastors that have made the decision to close their churches when we see the coming of the Lord so near. When the Bible says, forsake not the assembly of yourselves together, even the more so as you see the day of the Lord approaching. We're not supposed to scatter. Many shepherds and pastors have scattered the flocks. Their sheep are going here and there, getting a word from this church and this believer, this false prophet. We are living in the last day, and the enemy has set out a secret weapon. But I'm here to tell you that all of Israel and Saul was afraid, but God always has a remnant.
God, what time is it? Always has a remnant. Somebody say God has a remnant.
God has a remnant.
Somebody say God has a remnant.
God has a remnant.
Somebody say God has a remnant.
God has a remnant.
No weapon. Everybody focus with me. No weapon.
No weapon.
Formed
against me.
Shall prosper. Y'all, it's time to kill Goliath.
Amen.
Part two next Sunday. If you're here today, and you want to be saved,
Jesus.
If there's ever, hear me, I want y'all to hear me, even though streaming, if there's ever a time that men needed to be born again, born of the water and spirit, if there's ever a time people needed to be running to the altar to say, I want to be saved,
right,
this is the time. Hear me, the world is getting darker. The Bible says, work while it's day, because night comes when no man can work. There's going to come a day when there won't be no more work. Can I tell you something? And even those in stream, there's coming a day, watch this, there's coming a day when you're going to go to the church, and the church won't be nobody there to help you. That's going to, hear me, there's going to be a day people are going to run to the church, and the church won't be here. We're going to be gone. I wish they believed it. There's coming a day when God is coming to get his children. And I believe, and I told you, and I've been saying it, I'm going to shout it this year, probably more than any year I shout it. We are the raptured generation. There's not going to be a long generation off with the Lord. No, we are the raptured generation. And if you're not born again, you better stop. Let me say this. Stop listening to false preachers and tell you, just believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and confess with your mouth and you're saved. That's a lie from the pit. They take the scripture out of context. Jesus didn't tell you to confess. Jesus said you got to repent, be baptized, and be filled with his spirit. He said, except, here's what he said, except a man is born again of water, baptism, and of spirit, the Holy Ghost indwelling inside, you cannot see, enter, understand, or perceive the kingdom of God. You're not in the kingdom unless you're born into it. You don't say a sinner's prayer into the kingdom. Nowhere in the scripture do you see the apostles telling people to say a sinner's prayer. I don't care what Billy Graham said. Telling people to say a sinner's prayer and they're saved. That is unscriptural, it's satanic, and it ain't biblical. If you don't believe me, go to the book of Acts. The book of Acts is the birth and the foundation of the New Testament church, not the book of Romans, not Corinthians.
Come on, come on, come on.
There's only one way to get into the kingdom. You got to repent. You got to have a change of mind, a change of heart. You got to be baptized. You got to be buried in the name of Jesus for the remission or the removal of your sins. Yes. And then he promised you. This is what I love about it. After you've done your part, after you've done what he commanded you to do, not as commanded you to do, then he said, I shall give you the Holy Ghost for the promises unto you, your children, and to them that are. Pastor, why do you say that so much now? Because people need to hear it. And they've been lied to. They've been lied to. Preachers have been lying to people. Just believe what you say. That's a lie. The demons believe. And believe that preacher.
Come on. Come on.
You must. Everybody say you must.
You must.
You must. New Testament salvation is being born again. Jesus said it. The apostles taught it. And this little bitty boy from Brightwood, don't tell him to.
Amen.
Until the rapture, until I die. Anybody here want to be saved? If you're streaming and you don't have a home church and you say, Pastor Bear, I hear you. I want to be baptized in Jesus' name. If you would go to our website at www.judalite.com, www.judalite.com, and you have a question about salvation, let me say this as we close today. I love you. God loves you. Your soul is too important for me to lie to you. I'm going to say it again. I'm not called to be popular with people. I'm called to be popular with him. Your soul and my soul is too important to be lost. You go to our website and you have questions. You want to be baptized? You want to know more about New Testament salvation, not lies and religion? We'll be glad to share that with you in Jesus' name. God bless you. Lord willing, we'll be streaming on Thursday. Give God praise to you.